we light the candle of love. We believe what scriptures declare, that nothing in all creation can separate us from the love of God which is in Christ Jesus. Let us receive this Spirit into our hearts and respond in adoration of His pure and excellent love.
For God so loved the world that He gave His one and only Son, that whoever believes in Him shall not perish but have eternal life. Divine love for sinful humanity prompted Jesus coming to earth in human form.
Let us unite in prayer. Almighty God, our Father in heaven, we come before your glorious presence, ever mindful of your authority in heaven and on earth. Blessed be your name forever. We praise and thank you, Lord, for you are good. Your love endures forever. You have given us our lives, and you provide for everything that we need for life and godliness. You redeemed us by the atoning sacrifice of Jesus Christ, our Lord, and have given us the right to be called your children. In our pains and challenges, your Holy Spirit counsels us through your word and his power living in us. Indeed, O God, you are with us, you love us, and you are for us. Bless us and bless us indeed as we worship you and commune with you in the Spirit and in truth. Merciful Father, we come before your throne of grace and mercy to ask for our forgiveness. We have sinned against you. Search our hearts and lead us to your will. Gracious God, thank you for your love that is abounding in mercy. We put our trust in your word that the blood of Jesus Christ was shed for the forgiveness of sins for all those who believe in him. Thank you, Lord, for your pardon and for cleansing us of all unrighteousness. Thank you for restoring us to a right relationship with you and with our fellow men. In Jesus' name, Amen. Our scripture text today is taken from the Gospel according to Matthew, chapter 1, verses 18 to 24. This is how the birth of Jesus the Messiah came about. His mother Mary was pledged to be married to Joseph. But before they came together, she was found to be pregnant through the Holy Spirit. Because Joseph, her husband, was faithful to the law, and yet did not want to expose her to public disgrace, he had in mind to divorce her quietly. But after he had considered this, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream and said, "Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary home as your wife, because what is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will give birth to a son, and you are to give him the name Jesus, because he will save his people from their sins." All this took place to fulfill what the Lord had said through the prophet, "The virgin will conceive and give birth to a son, and they will call him Emmanuel," which means God with us. When Joseph woke up, he did what the angel of the Lord had commanded him and took Mary home as his wife. But he did not consummate their marriage until she gave birth to a son, and he gave him the name Jesus. The Lord has already added his blessings to the reading of his word. The accounts about our dear Lord Jesus' birth that we find in Matthew and Luke are of paramount importance in our understanding and knowing who Jesus is, particularly his earthly beginnings. The Nicene Creed, which is a summary statement of the Orthodox faith of the Christian Church, includes our faith in the facts about his birth that we know from the gospel narratives, namely, that Jesus Christ is the Son of God Almighty, the Creator of heaven and earth, and that he came down from heaven, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate, meaning he took on human form as an infant from the Virgin Mary. He came for us and our salvation. The Gospel of John focuses on the eternal pre-existence of Jesus Christ, which is also stated in the Nicene Creed, thus, "Eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him, all things were made." These are the foundations that ground us in our faith and the reason why Jesus' birth is good news. That is why we need not be afraid. Jesus is born. Fear not. The account of Jesus' birth from the perspective of real human persons such as Mary and Joseph are given in the Bible because they are the primary personalities being the mother and the husband of Mary, and we could very well relate to their situation. They had every reason to be severely stressed by the birth of Jesus Christ. In the case of Joseph, described as a person who was faithful to the law of Moses, he was faced with the devastating news that his fiancée, whom he loved so much, was pregnant even before they could come together as husband and wife. The law of their time would have required Mary to be stoned for her adultery if she were impregnated by a man other than her betrothed, Joseph. But because Joseph loved her, despite this, he planned just to divorce her or cancel their betrothal secretly. A man in Joseph's shoes would probably find this situation very stressful indeed. What else is there in store for his future when he had pinned his hopes on this woman whom he loved to be his partner for life and together with her build a family of their own? You probably know of someone who had become so broken-hearted to the point of hopelessness because of the affairs of the heart. From the perspective of Mary, on the other hand, in the Gospel of Luke, we read that an angel announced to her that she would conceive and give birth to a son, not by Joseph, but by the power of the Holy Spirit. Now, if you were in Mary's place, wouldn't you also be afraid of this strange phenomenon? From a practical standpoint, wouldn't you be concerned about the stigma attached to a child born out of wedlock, especially during those times when the punishment for adultery was a public stoning for the unfaithful fiancé? But to both Joseph and Mary, God gave this command and comfort through an angel. Do not be afraid. Three key points on why they should not be afraid and why they overcame their fears. First, they had the humility to believe and obey God. Humility in this case, the sense of meekness, makes a person submissive to a greater authority. I am reminded of a commonly known military training dictum that goes something like this: obey before you complain. This means that if a superior gives a task or a command, the subordinate is to humbly obey without complaining or without any objections like a spoiled brat, trusting his superior's judgment enough and showing the proper respect due to him. Only after the task is done may the subordinate or trainee request perhaps for an explanation or the rationale behind the order that was given. It seems like in this way, the subordinate has no time to let his fear overtake him, and before he knows it, the job is done and he has accomplished what was ordered for him. Now, granted, the angel explained the circumstances, as we read, like Mary's virginity, God's plan for her son to save people from their sins, among others. It was explained as we can read from the scriptures. But still, we have to credit Joseph for his prompt obedience. The narrative says that when Joseph awoke. He did what the angel commanded him, that is to marry Mary right away to save her from public disgrace instead of divorcing her. Because in truth and in fact, she is innocent of adultery. And Joseph humbly obeyed without putting up a fight against God's difficult but promising plans for his life and for the world through Jesus. Mary was likewise humbly submitted to God's design for Jesus' life. Although she was greatly troubled at the words of the visiting angel about her coming pregnancy, however, because of the strangeness of the process that she was going to go through, we can perceive her humble spirit when she responded, "I am the Lord's servant. May your word to me be fulfilled." We can take this observation as a lesson for us in the way we react to the perplexing and difficult situations we find ourselves in. Instead of being quick to complain, calculate, and conclude with fear, listen to the voice of God in your heart and believe He is sovereign. Humbly trust and obey. If He says wait, proceed, or step back. It is not easy to wait or to go ahead or even to retreat, especially when it takes sacrifice, when it means losing something like some possession or status or maybe even losing face or losing a loved one. But like Joseph and Mary, humble obedience will enable us to forget our fears and step right into God's will and ways. When this happens, we facilitate the fulfillment of God's best plans for our lives. Joseph and Mary had the honor and privilege of raising the Son of God in human form, the Savior of the world, their own Savior, because of their humility. Above all, the Bible repeatedly points out the humility of Jesus Christ Himself, who was obedient to God the Father to death, even death on the cross. Jesus, as a human being, underwent severe stress to the point of anguish, as the Bible tells us, so that in the Garden of Gethsemane, His sweat was like that of droplets of blood falling to the ground. But in prayer, He received the power of humility to submit to God's will, not His will. And from there on, he courageously faced the suffering of the cross. Secondly, Jesus' birth drives away fear because by it, God proved His love for us. 1 John 4:14 says, "And we have seen and testify that the Father has sent His Son to be the Savior of the world. If anyone acknowledges that Jesus is the Son of God, God lives in them and they in God." And so we know and rely on the love God has for us. God is love. Whoever lives in love lives in God, and God in them. This is how love is made complete among us, so that we will have confidence on the day of judgment. In this world, we are like Jesus. There is no fear in love, but perfect love drives out fear because fear has to do with punishment. In the account about the angels declared, She will give birth to a son, and you are to give him the name Jesus, because he will save his people from their sins. From the very beginning, Satan has caused people to lose their security in the belief and in the thought of the hands being in the hands of a great and loving God. Sin caused Adam and Eve to hide from God. Satan is the tempter and at the same time the accuser that keeps us in doubt about our standing before God. But Jesus came to earth to die in our place for the forgiveness of sins and for the favor of God to be poured out upon those who believe in him. They will not perish, but will have everlasting life. What is a problem, a difficult situation, or a threat that can be greater than the eternal punishment for sin? Is there any cause of fear that could be more than the fear of eternal punishment? Jesus was born to be offered to all for the forgiveness of sin. So, do not be afraid of the far lesser problems compared to that of your eternal destiny, which is now secure because of Jesus Christ's coming to earth. Remember God's perfect love through Jesus Christ is offered to you to cast fear out of your very life. He does not want us to be living in constant fear for our lives. He loves us, and because Jesus is in us, his favor is upon us. We are like Jesus. The favor of the Father has also been given to us, just as it has been given upon Jesus, the beloved Son of God. God is in all things working for the good of those who love him, who are called according to his purpose. Third and last, we need not fear because Jesus is Emmanuel, God with us. Before Jesus came into the world, God seemed too distant and unreachable to human beings. But when Jesus came as a human baby, people were able to live with him and he with his own people. People saw, heard, and touched him. He touched the people with his healing, his miracles, his miraculous provisions, his voice, his teachings, his words of truth. He showed them, and he continues to show us what God is like. A Father in heaven to be obeyed, and at the same time, a Father who forgives when we disobey and repent. He showed us what loving God and other people means in the spirit and in outward demonstration, in practical ways. Though now Jesus is no longer present physically, he is with us by the Holy Spirit, whose power continues to work in and through us. Fear not. God is in us, in the innermost parts of our beings. God is with us like never before because Jesus came as a human being and accomplished his mission. Hebrews 1 says, "In the past, God spoke to our ancestors through the prophets at many times and at various ways. But in these last days, he has spoken to us by his Son, whom he appointed heir of all things, and through whom also he made the universe. The sun is the radiance of God's glory and the exact representation of His being, sustaining all things by His powerful word. After He had provided purification for sins, He sat down at the right hand of the Majesty in heaven. So He became as much superior to the angels as the name He has inherited is superior to theirs. He is King of Kings and Lord of Lords. In Jesus Christ, God Himself has and is continuously speaking to us with superior authority than the prophets and the angels, because Jesus Christ is the exact representation of God's being, and He holds all things by His powerful word. Yes, God spoke through the angels, and the angels said that God spoke through the prophets, particularly in the birth of our Lord Jesus Christ. But after that, when Jesus came and lived His life here on earth, He left us not only a word, not many words, but the whole counsel of God's truth, which are preserved in the Bible. The prophets spoke about Him, the angels spoke and announced His coming, saying, "Do not be afraid." But Jesus Christ Himself spoke to His disciples, apostles, and continued to speak to us today through the written word of God, the Bible. The verses in Hebrews say, Jesus Christ is superior to them all. And He Himself tells us today, "Fear not, for I am with you. Emmanuel, God with us." Dear brothers and sisters in Christ, Jesus is born. Jesus has come. Fear not. When we focus on God and on what He has accomplished in sending Jesus Christ to earth, we learn the secret of facing our life's troubles and challenges with confidence. God's confidence, not in ourselves, but confidence in God. We will learn about living our lives for God. Therefore, we will not fear. We will learn how to conquer fear with faith. Humbly obey. Believe in God's love that is after your best interest. Jesus Christ, Son of God, is with us. His word is above all. His word will stand. Remember these, and let His word in the Bible fill your hearts and minds so that you may live the present fruitfully, joyfully, and face the future not only with confidence in God, but in fruitful obedience, making most of every opportunity to serve Him, no matter the changing seasons of life, and serving Him to the praise, honor, and glory of His name. Amen. Shall we pray? Indeed, Almighty God, Jesus Christ, the name above all names, the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, has been born to us, and having accomplished His mission, He now stands before us in all His glory, continuously inviting us to put our trust in Him. Thank you, Lord, for teaching us, reminding us once again that we need not fear, because Jesus came to drive out all fears, and to put our confidence and trust in you. Lord, we ask that you help us in times of trouble, in times of severe stress and the burdensome realities of life, to remember that Jesus' birth on that night when the opportune time had come, you sent Jesus Christ so that we may have confidence in your love. We may have confidence in the power of your Holy Spirit because of Jesus Christ's life, works, and sacrifice. Lord, there are some of us who may be undergoing stresses and problems that cause them to fear. We pray, Lord, that this fear will be simply temporary, and that your perfect love will drive out these fears. Lord, replace this with a gift of faith and the assurance of your love and grace, so that we may not be tempted once again by the evil one to live in fear. We are more than conquerors, even of our fears, through Jesus Christ, who loves us and who gave himself for us. Father, we pray also for those who are grateful and truly thankful, Lord, for all the wonderful things that you have been doing in their lives. We too pray, O God, that this thanksgiving and praise may result in a life that is full of joy, confidence in you, and service to others, to be channels of comfort to those who need comforting at this time. Lord, we also praise you for your goodness to those who are in need of provisions for their daily lives. Provisions, Lord, for the near future, knowing that their plans for their family, for their children, and even our plans for the church need your provisions, Lord, in all forms. We trust you, O God, that your mission, your ministry for us, whether this be with our family or with our in our church or even in a greater society, will be provided for, Lord. We trust, Father, that you will carry them out according to your plans and purposes. Father, we also lift up to you our this time when we are celebrating the Advent season. We pray, O God, that more worship and prayer will rise to you, so that we may be able to receive the grace to do that which is pleasing in your sight. May we glorify your name, O God, in everything that we do, so that the world will know that indeed Jesus Christ is in us and that Jesus Christ is Lord. Father, we ask that you touch now the hearts and minds of those of us who are listening and who have participated in this worship. Lord, may we not go out of this hour unchanged, but Lord, we pray that your word will dwell richly in our hearts and will result in the kind of transformation that you want for each one of us. Father, we ask for your mercy and your grace upon not only our church, but even for our nation, especially as the year draws to a close. And for the world around us, Lord, have mercy upon us, Lord, and let your light, the light of Jesus Christ, continue to shine even through us, your church, the light of the world, the salt of the earth, as Jesus said. In his name we pray. Amen. My dear brothers and sisters in Christ, may the love of God fill you with joy in his presence, now and always. May you proclaim the message of your new life in Christ in word and through your surrendered lives to Jesus Christ. May you make his praise glorious in every season. In the name of God the Father, Jesus Christ the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. A blessed third Sunday in Advent, everyone. For our announcements, may I remind you that our Simbang Gabi is online every 7 o'clock in the evening, and the next Simbang Gabi will be tomorrow, December 14, followed by the 16th, 18th, 21st, and 23rd. I hope that many of you can join us in the Zoom meeting where the Simbang Gabi is held. Also, we continue to provide you with Advent family devotional guides that you can use for the week. And we are now on the third week of Advent, and expect your devotionals within this week. We pray that you may be helped and blessed by the lessons as you reflect upon them as a family or as a household. And lastly, we would like to greet our celebrants. Happy birthday to Joey Antonio, Isaiah Antonio, Belia Arroco, Juven Avila, Lea Permaran, Romel Salut, Joanna Marie Torres, Jana Monique Umali, Belen Rapore, and Donna Arroco. Happy birthday to all of you. And happy wedding anniversary to Jeffrey and Marigirl Padilla, and Romel and Myrna Salut. Let us pray for our brothers and sisters. Let us pray. We praise you and thank you once again, O God, for the lives of these our brothers and sisters in Christ who are celebrating their birthdays this week. We thank you, Lord, for bringing them to our fellowship. We thank you, Lord, for making them part of this family of believers here in our church. We pray, O God, that you will continue to bless them as you have blessed them in the past. And we pray that they will be able to hear your voice and be able to understand your answer to their prayers. Lord, we pray that they will never lose hope, but keep on believing and putting their confidence in you. Father, we also pray for the two couples who are celebrating their wedding anniversaries. Thank you, Father, for the gift of love between husband and wife. We pray, Father, that you will continue to just guide them in the way that they should go, and that their love for each other, O Lord, will come from their love for you above all. May they continue to be a blessing to their children, and may their children call them blessed. Thank you, Father. This is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. Goodbye, everyone, and we hope to see you in our Simbang Gabi and in our other Sunday worship services. God bless you.